You know, I almost named this video Vulnerable and Clueless, because unfortunately, that is so many people's reality right now when it comes to the regulations of their own bank accounts. I mean, they trust the banks. And even more so, after a new Reg D requirement change. Now, I've never seen this quite like this before, let's face it, and it's my job to show you these things quickly so that you can have enough time to do something about it. So that's exactly what I'm going to do. Coming up. I'm Lynette Zang, Chief Market Analyst here at ITM Trading, a full-service physical gold and silver dealer. And as you guys know, we specialize in custom strategies, and you need to have one because they have a plan. You need to have a plan. Look, ignorance doesn't make you immune. It just leaves you vulnerable. So let's talk about what's going on in the banking system. Because really, what I see the Feds doing, not a big shocker, is positioning for the end. The end of the wealth transfer, when you're left with nothing and they've got everything. You know, it struck me as I was putting this together, and I just wanted to go over this with you. The Federal Reserve, the central bank of the United States, provides the nation with a safe, flexible, and stable monetary and financial system. Do they really do that? Because in my opinion, they don't. There's so many unintended consequences to their actions and their behaviors. But here's an intended consequence, and that is the CPI, the inflation, which now we are hearing ad nauseum. While this inflation is really kicking into gear, you're going to see prices noticeably go up. So keep track of this time. So many times people go and they're not really paying a whole lot of attention, and then they go, gee, did the price of that just go up? Yeah, but we are now entering a period of high inflation. They want you to think that it's transitory, but I gotta ask you, does this look particularly transitory to you? This inflation is not transitory. Those prices do not come down. I'm telling you, you better be prepared for big inflation, because it's going to be really noticeable and it's not going to be transitory. It could very well push us into hyperinflation. The only difference between inflation and hyperinflation is the speed of the inflation. This is the purchasing power. And this is just since this is 2008 here, because I want you to see that even officially it continues to go down, because 100% of the time, at some point, hard to say exactly when, all assets and all instruments go to their true fundamental intrinsic value. And the true value of any government currency that is based on inflation is zero. Who does that hurt? Does that hurt a Jeff Bezos? No. He's not going to care. Actually, he's going to benefit from the inflation of all the products that he sells at Amazon. The whole system is what is set up to create that income and wealth inequality. Janet Yellen came out and said, I don't think there's going to be an inflationary problem, but if there is, the Fed can be counted on to address it. This is how they've addressed it. What do you think? How do you think they have provided the nation with a safe, flexible, and stable monetary and financial system? Maybe for the few, but definitely not for the many. Let's talk about the banks, of which, of course, the Federal Reserve oversees. Banks and credit unions are required by federal law to have a certain amount of cash on hand, which is also called reserve requirements, to make sure they have enough cash to cover their customers' demand for withdrawals. In January of 2019, the Fed came out and said, we are going to have an ample reserve regime. That means, well, That means that they can print all the reserves that the banks need. So now they have changed the reserve requirements of depository institutions. The final rule amending its Reg D reserve requirements of depository institutions to lower reserve requirement ratios on transaction accounts maintained at depository institutions to zero. So they do not have to hold any reserves. What they're talking about here is on transaction accounts. But in the same change to Reg D, they reclassified savings accounts as transaction accounts. So in 95, in order to give the banks more money to work with and trade with, what did they do? They created sweep accounts. So you make a deposit into your account, bank account, they sweep those funds to a sub account that is actually in their name, and then they can use those, that reserve, or as collateral to go borrow for their benefit. Well, it certainly benefited them a lot. We saw how it didn't benefit people when we went through the 2007-2008 crisis. They're taking it a huge step further. They are reclassifying savings into transaction accounts. So that means that they want you to use that money in those savings accounts. And the banks do not have to hold reserves. So what happens the next time there's a run on the bank? Well, if they can get everything digital before that happens, too bad, so sad for those that hold all of their money in the banks. The ample reserve regime means creating unlimited fiat money. But every time they do that, the value of the currency goes down. That's why you gotta have gold. That's why you gotta have silver, because that's real money. This is the Fed balance sheet, and going back to 2008, and you can see that it just continues to go up and up and up as they create more and more new money. The first time that the Federal Reserve had to buy government treasuries were December 2002. They don't even want to go back that far anymore because they don't want you to realize that's what a third world country does, because there's not enough demand for our government debt so that the Fed has to buy it themselves. They get the banks to help them do that. These are treasuries held by Federal Reserve banks. Do you see what I'm saying here? They just create this stuff, but it's the taxpayers and the depositors and the general public that are not too big to fail and that are typically left on the hook. The goal of Regulation D to begin with was to create a clear line between savings accounts and transactions accounts. Savings accounts are meant to encourage long-term saving, not short-term spending. When the crisis hit and all the stimulus money was sent out because they couldn't just take care of Wall Street this time, there was no way that would have been tolerated. They had to also take care of the public, at least to a degree. Those at the top still get the greatest benefit. We saw savings spike because people were scared. They didn't know the next job they were gonna have, how their money was coming in. Then it declined, but it's back up there. And this goes back to 1960 when they started tracking it. So you can certainly see that we are significantly historically higher. People save money when they are unsure. And we've certainly been watching the monetary velocity charts. We had a little bump up. I said we have to wait and see if that's pervasive. Well, it's declining again. This is the most current DIF fund. This is the FDIC's insurance fund to cover all of these deposits. The highest level that it reached was in 1219, and it has been declining ever since. So what that means to you is they have 1.29% to cover your insured deposits. Forget the uninsured deposits, but the insured deposits, or about a penny and a third, not quite, but almost a penny and a third to cover every insured dollar in those accounts. What we saw in 2008 was so many banks going out. According to the FDIC, if even one more small bank had failed, it would have been obvious that they were out of money in this DIF fund. I have to ask you if this makes you feel particularly comfy and safe to hold your money in the banking system. Now, of course, we're tied into the system. So we have to keep a certain level of money in there. Maybe you have automatic withdrawals or what have you. But personally, I keep a minimum level in there because I can always make a deposit. But as we've seen in other countries, when there is a banking crisis, and they're, I mean, I think this is setting up for bail-in, where they bail in your deposits. Well, quite honestly, you can't always get money out. So if you haven't yet built a certain level of cash outside of the system, you might really want to consider doing it while you still have the chance, because I think this is setting up for you to lose that opportunity. Because as I said earlier, banks are still deemed too big to fail. These are the excess reserves of the depository institution that you could see when they started paying interest on it, and also, you know, basically giving the banks this money to hold. Now, they discontinued showing us this in August of 2020. Since they are no longer required to hold these reserves, they can go down to zero, all of this money could now be used for more derivative bets. It's a leveraged bet, and its price action is based on the price movement of the underlying, whether it's interest rates or stocks or foreign exchange or precious metals or anything. So these, this orange line here, those are speculative trading derivatives in the FDIC insured banks. Down here are the end user non-trading derivatives. This is speculation. This is not. I'd say you can see that it's a pretty big difference. And since these are all contract paper markets, well, quite honestly, they're pretty easy to manipulate, because we certainly don't want to change behavior. We want to change the rules so we can still act poorly. But hey, it's legalized. It's okie dokie. I just need to remind you so you can see the additional risk that's being built into this system with what they call compression activity. Whenever you hear the term notional or nominal, what that tells you is that the true value at risk is being hidden. The true value is being hidden. The notional amount of banks' contracts have generally declined since 2013. It declined since 2013 because of trade compression efforts, leading to less need for risk management products. Well, did that risk really go away? No. Actually, the risk has now infiltrated every single Wall Street product that there is, pretty much. But trade compression continues to be a significant factor in reducing the amount of notional derivatives outstanding. So even going back to that last chart, do you really have any idea what the notional value is at risk, let alone the real value that is at risk? No, we don't know it. Nobody knows it. Even the guys that create this stuff, they have no clue. But this is what that looks like. This makes those derivative piles look a lot smaller. The amount of netting compression activity that's gone on has been increasing as well. So I'll just go back to this really briefly. Do we know how many derivatives are speculative, trading derivatives are in the system? We do not. And yet, you should feel safe, because after all, your money is insured by a little bit more than a penny for every dollar. That makes me feel real cozy and comfy. This is the notional amount of precious metal derivative contracts. I mean, you can see that that is substantially higher than it was. So could they suppress the price of gold and silver? And this is just one little place. This is just in the FDIC insured banks. This is not globally. This is not even in it, you know, trading accounts, etc. This is just the FDIC insured banks. You can create an unlimited amount and control assets, real assets, that are in limited supply. You have to determine for yourself, how do I want to be positioned when this whole house of cards goes down? Even the Fed is coming out and saying, wow, there's got to be a market correction because people are just feasting on risk. The risk that they created. Is that the unintended consequences? Does this really create a safe and stable financial system? No, it does not. So if you haven't created a plan that includes food, water, energy, security, as well as barterability, wealth preservation, community, and shelter, if you haven't started yet, get started. Because I don't know how much more time we have, but I do know, and you know, I mean, come on. You can see the insanity all around us. And even though things can last and be insane a lot longer than we would think possible, it doesn't happen forever. And there's no doubt in my mind but that we are very, very close. I don't know how much longer they can postpone it. They have no tools other than money printing. And it's not working. And they're printing more and more and getting less and less result. And that's been true for more than a decade, since 2008. So please, people, get into position. Here we use the wealth shield, which is about sustaining your standard of living and even enabling you to thrive so that when this wealth transfers, a lot of it may transfer your way. That's what this is about. Have it transfer your way. And until next we meet, please be safe out there. Bye-bye.